Cast is now starting. All attendees are in listen-only mode.
Hello, Alfonso. How are you?
Yes.
Yes.
Can you?
Yeah, good. Can you hear me? Oh, yeah, I can see.
Yeah.
Okay. I will, everybody can hear me. We have 25 students at this moment. If there is some noise on your side, that is, everybody can hear it. Okay, so number one. So if there's some noise, most likely I'm going to turn off the microphone from everybody because everybody will share the noise. So let's see. Okay, so I will wait a couple more minutes just to start the review. Angela, hi, how are you? Can you hear me? All right, Shelby. Can you hear me, Shelby? Okay, so far Alfonso is the only one can hear me. Okay, so let me see. Queen. Okay. Queen, can you see me? Queen?
Hi, yes.
Yes, you can. Can you see what you see in the screen at this moment?
I didn't see the screen, but I can.
No, the screen is on, so you should see me. Can you see the screen? Can you see the lecture?
Yes, I do.
What do you see there?
The lecture 3, anatomy and physiology, the PowerPoint.
Well, okay.
Is that
okay. All right, thank you.
You're
Olivia, hi, how are you?
Hi, good.
Excellent. All right, so I cannot mention everybody because I have 26 students so far. Nadia, hi, how are you? Noelia, Millicent, Melissa, Ginoline, Jessica, Jennifer, Iris, Ingrid, Hannah, Erica, Eliandra. All right, thank you, everybody. So we are going to start our review for Victorian Munoz, hi. We are going to start our review. I'm going to put the speaker off so I cannot hear your noise, but you can hear me. If there's a problem with that, there is a questions. You can, if you go into your right side, you see questions here. Questions, and actually you can, if you write questions right now, oh, Ingrid, thank you. You just send me a message. All right, I can see now the screen, perfect. So if there is some questions, let me know. You can raise your hand, and that is, we are going to start now. All right, so let's start. Okay, so let me cut the noise for everybody. Yes, a moment. Welcome everybody to our review webinar. Today is about lecture number three. And we are going to talk about the integumentary system and the body temperature. So this review obviously is not going to be a 4 hour review. It's not going to be probably not even 1 hour review. The intention of this is to remark the main topics that you are going, you need to really keep in your mind passing this lecture. All right, so let's start. So we was talking about the integumentary system, and you know, integumentary system is actually all the covers that are in the in your body. So for example, we have the cover in, cover out of the body. Cover out will be the skin, cover in is going to be all the lining of the tissue. Over the lining of the hollow organs. All right, so here, important about this, just remember, just big considerations here. We have three layers: epidermis, dermis, and hypodermis. Dermis, epidermis, and hypodermis. So we have three. Epidermis is on the top. The only thing I want you to remember about this epidermis, we have not even that we have many layers on the epidermis, but the only structure that you need to find are going to be the melanocytes. The melanocytes. The melanocytes are located in this area. So if you see here, this is the stratus corneum. This is the epidermis from here to here, from here to here, to here to here, from here to here. All these area is the epidermis. So this area you see here, like different, that is still epidermis. What are these cells? Those are the corneal cells. Corneal cells contain the keratin. So all this from here to here is the epidermis. Epidermis, 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 epidermis. We know that these cells will be replacing the ones who are above. And the ones who are more exteriorly are going to slough off. So the ones who are coming from below are going to replace the one who is in the upper level. And that is going to be like circulating the skin, and always the cells reproduce se new cells, and the old cells at outside are going to be slough off. So that means we have here these cells are the corneal cells are dead cells, actually are dead cells. All right, so what we have in the epidermis? The melanocytes, melanocytes, melanocytes. What are the melanocytes? Are cells who contain a pigment called the melanin, and the melanin give you the color of your skin. Okay? Just to remember about the subcutaneous tissue, subcutaneous tissue. Subcutaneous tissue is under the dermis. So this is the epidermis, this is the dermis, this is the dermis, and below all of these two layers, we have the hypodermis or subcutaneous tissue or subcutaneous layer. So that I put some syringes there. Why? Because that is where is going to go the subcutaneous injection. So for example, here we have, this is the subcutaneous. You see here the subcutaneous here is going to pass the epidermis and go reach the level of subcutaneous tissue. The absorption here of the medication is going to be about 10 minutes. 10 minutes. Here we have intramuscular. The intramuscular is, as you see, the needle is going to pass the epidermis, the dermis, hypodermis, and this is the muscular tissue. This is the intramuscular. The any injection you put it, injections are going to start making effect about 15 minutes after injection. The intradermal, can you see here intradermal? Intradermal is in between the layers of the skin. Okay, so that is actually they are going to be located especially under the layer of called the epidermis. So if you notice here, if you receive some intradermal injection for, I mean, test of some, for example, TB test or some allergies, the injection is going to be in this angle, very almost zero angle. The subcutaneous is going to be 15 degrees. So that is the way that we reach the subcutaneous tissue. All right, so let's not go out of the picture. So I want just to finish this subcutaneous tissue, and what do we have in this subcutaneous tissue? In this subcutaneous tissue, we have so many structures. We have the dermis layer. We have here what is this? Is the hair follicle. The hair follicle. This is the hair. The black is the hair itself. The brown is the hair itself. This kind of purple around is the hair follicle. Is where the hair start to grow. Each hair follicle with the hair is going to be companion with a sweat gland. Sweat gland could be in your arms, in your legs, in your back, in your chest. Any place that you have hair, they are going to just have these sweat glands. On the head, you're going to have these, in addition, sebaceous glands. These sebaceous glands are mostly located in the face and the scalp, on the back of the body. The sweat glands are more distributed all over the body. So, for example, when you sweat, what is getting oily? Your face, for example, right? Your hands are not going to be oily. Behind your hands, the torso, are not going to be oily when you sweat, right? So that is telling you that the sebaceous glands and the sweat glands are going to be variable according to the location in the body. So we have more sweat glands here. If you see here, this duct, this green is the duct that is going to make the sweat gland drain the fluid into the surface of the skin. That's why it's called exocrine. Okay, so that is about that. I want you to remember how the body is going to regulate the temperature, right? If you are too hot, you're going to have basal dilation. That's why the skin gets red. Why? Because basal dilation get closer to the skin, the vessel, and practically you can see through the skin. So that's why your cheeks become red. That is to control the temperature. So when you're hot, you're trying to control the temperature in your body. What you're doing is basal dilation. This basal dilation make the blood getting closer to the skin. You start to sweat. The water in the skin start to evaporate, and the evaporation plus the blood that is closer to the skin is going to make dissipate or go away the heat from the body through the evaporation. Okay, so and the opposite, when you have cold, very cold, what happened is the opposite, a basal constriction. Okay, to keep the temperature, the blood temperature away from the surface, that is cold, and to keep the temperature in deeper levels in the body. Okay, so we are going to talk about some of the lesions. I want you to remember the macule. The macule, we have the freckles and we have the moles, right? So this is very important. So the freckles and moles are not elevated, and they are flat. They're very, very, this is a macule, very defined borders. When these defined borders start to be irregular, that means that it should be observed, because it could be some malignant changes on the skin, especially on those patients who are actually white or fair skin. Okay, so talking about the burns, you have the superficial is the first degree. Second degree, there are two: superficial partial sickness and deep partial sickness, superficial and deep. Those two are the second degree. And the third degree is the full sickness. So first, second, third. Superficial, we have is pain and redness. superficial and deep. This is the second degree. In both cases, you're going to find blisters. So blisters, accumulation of water in vesicles. But what is the difference? So they have superficial partial thickness is second degree blisters. Deep partial thickness is second degree blisters. Superficial partial thickness is going to have some pain, still having some pain, but blister, with blister. And the deep partial start to have, you have blisters and the pain start to go down. So that means that it's destroying more of that nerves endings on the dermis. In the dermis, remember, it's everything: arteries, veins, nerves, hair, the muscle erector, right? So all is are mostly in the dermis. Another very important high yield here, please, is about the percentage of burns. So please, I want you to remember head, all the head, anterior and posterior of the head, all the surface around the head is 9%. 9% is going to be the anterior and all the surface, all the whole arm, anterior and posterior of the arm is going to be 9%. Then we have the other arm 9%, the lower extremity, is going to be like two arms, right? So 18%, this 18% means the surface anterior and posterior all together. That is 19%. 19% of the lower extremity, and we have the trunk. The trunk is going to be 36%. So it's 18% anteriorly and 18% posteriorly. The whole trunk is going to be 36%. All right, so is that clear? All right, so and the perineum will count with 1% of the whole tissue, of the whole area. All right, so just remember, we have dermatosis. Dermatosis is the term that refers to the disease of the integumentary system, any skin disease. So what is dermatosis? Any disturbance or any alteration of the skin. So what do you have? Dermatosis. But it's just a general thing. It's not like a specific. For a specific, we can talk dermatitis, atopic dermatitis, psoriasis, cancers, etc. Okay? So now, about the acne, that's what I want you to remember. All the surfaces are having mostly staphylococcus and streptococcus. These two bacteria can produce a problem, an infection of the skin that is called the impetigo. So staphylococcus, streptococcus are everywhere, are waiting just for your immune system go down in order to actually invade your skin. All right, so we have some pictures that we went before, and let's talk about the skeletal system. The skeletal system, the first thing that we recall is 206 bones, right? And this is what I really want you to remember. Functions of the skeletal system. A framework, number one, framework, the structure of the body, right? Is the beams of the building, let's put it that way, the framework. Protect is going to protect all the structures. In the skull, we have the cranium. And the cranium is going to have the brain. So that bone is covering and protecting the brain. Same here in the thorax, protecting the lungs and protecting the heart, the pelvis protecting the uterus, the ovaries, okay? Work of levers to produce movement. So those are mechanical forces are going to play an important role of the movement of the body. So how we are going to lift a weight, how we are going to, how is the best way to use these mechanics in order not to injure, for example, your back. So you will learn that in the fundamentals when you are going to lift, you learn how to lift a patient. And for that, you need to separate your make a base, a long base, separating your legs in front of the patient in order to lift. And that is a technique. So you will know that in your fundamentals. Store calcium salts. Calcium, calcium, calcium. Calcium is so important. Please don't just think that calcium is to make the bone hard. It's not only that. Calcium is a very important element that is stored on the bones, and that is when you need or when you are low of calcium, the calcium is being released by the bones. Why do we need calcium? We need calcium for everything. We need calcium for muscle contraction. For example, your biceps, you do exercises, you need calcium for that. For you need to move the diaphragm, for example, it's a muscle. What they need calcium too. Calcium, calcium, calcium is important. Your heart, how is going to contract? Because they need calcium. Okay, your muscles, when you are exercising, you are making calcium get it inside the cells in order to be able to make happen the contraction. Okay, so any of these are going to the peristalsis. Any muscle that is moving, they are going to always need calcium. So you can understand now, if you have low levels of calcium in your body, what is the storage where you are going to take hand for calcium are the bones. Just to make a shortcut here, the bones are being reabsorbed by a cell called the osteoclast. 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 Okay. All right. So produce blood cells. Please don't take it like a simple word there. So I want really you to focus in the functions of the skeleton of production of blood cells. Blood cells. So please, number one, red blood cells. Red blood cells. Number two, platelets. Number three, white cells. White cells, red blood cells, and platelets. Platelets, white cells, and red blood cells. Red blood cells, platelets, and white cells. So those three lines are being produced by the bone. Which part of the bone? The red bone marrow. Red bone marrow. Okay? All this production, all this process together is called a hematopoiesis. Hemato. Hemato means blood, right? And that part of that the other name that we call when we produce red blood cells is called the erythropoiesis. Erythropoiesis. Erythro means red, right? Red. So hemato means blood. So blood is more general than erythro. Erythro is red blood cells. So under the big umbrella of hematopoiesis, we have three lines. The erythropoiesis, the production of white cells, and the production of platelets. All right. So this we have one thing I want to remark, very important, please, everybody. Okay, we're still having more students coming. Thank you for that. We have the division of the bone. So here we have, okay, I'm going to stop a few minutes here because I want you to understand and you have cleared this. We have, this is a long bone. Okay, the long bone is called, why? Because the central is longer than the distal portions. It's more prominent, that's why it's called long bone. So, for example, the clavicle too is short, but it's actually look like small, but it's considered a long bone because the medial portion is larger than the distal portions. Now, we have the epiphysis, we have the diaphysis, and we have the epiphysis. Epiphysis and epiphysis. Two epiphyses, distal, both of them are distal. Those are in the extremes of the bones, epiphysis, epiphysis. Epiphysis and epiphysis. In the middle, we have the diaphysis. Please write it down a few times. That diaphysis is called the central shaft or just shaft. Shaft. Okay, so be careful with that. Diaphysis is the same to say in this case shaft or the central shaft of a long bone. So talking about the diaphysis or the shaft of the long bone, we have in the center a cavity representing in this cartoon. This graphic is like, imagine like a cave, like a tunnel, some cavity inside. This cavity in the middle of the bone in the diaphysis or shaft contain the red, sorry, the yellow marrow. Yellow marrow. What is yellow marrow? Fat. What is the function of the fat? Storage. Just that. So it's not going to have any really other function than that. Second, we have here the epiphyses. In the epiphyses, we have many structures. We have the red bone marrow. So if you see here this close up, this is the red bone marrow or bone marrow, if you want, but it's actually properly called red bone marrow. Where is the red bone marrow? Here. Red bone marrow. Here is the red bone marrow on the epiphyses in both sides. All right, so we have two types of bones. We have the compact bone and the cancellous bone. Before that, remember this. The inner lining of the medullary cavity, where is the yellow marrow, is called the endosteum. Then we have, open eyes, open ears, the periosteum, that is the outer, is the membrane covering the bone. It's a membrane. Endosteum is covering the inner portion of the bone in the medullary cavity where the yellow marrow is. And the periosteum is the membrane that is covering the outer portion of the bone. Okay? And periosteum is a fibrous tissue, very strong. That is one of the membranes that make very stiff the bone, not easy to get broken. And that is the periosteum. Periosteum is the outer membrane of the bone. Okay. All right, so I want just to remember here the picture of the video that we saw about the formation of a bone. What is this called? This structure is called the osteon. Osteon is the functional unit of the bone. I want just to remember this, and this put highlight 10 times here. Harvation system is the same to say osteon. Osteon or Harvation system are the same. Harvation system. Harvest was the first doctor who was describing through a microscope the structures of the bone. So in his honor, they put the Harvation system. Osteons, but it's the same to say osteon, that is the functional unit of the bone. Forget about Harvation canal, all the stuff. Just remember what is really important here. Osteon is the Harvation system. What is are these is are the functional units of the bone. All right, so we have the spongy bone. Can you see the spongy bone? Mostly the spongy bone is located in the epiphysis of the bone. We have a spongy bone, trabecular bone, or cancellous bone. So those are more fragile. They are not so hard as the diaphysis. So where are the most hardest part of the bone is in the diaphysis, on the diaphysis. Why? Because here we have the compact bone or dense bone. Okay? All right, so that is the location of the compact bone. We have the osteon, is the same to say Harvation system. Okay, so here we have many Harvation system. We have a Harvation artery or Harvation canal with the artery. So this piece looks like a cork. That is what? The osteon. If you remember these lines here, lines like a circular lines, each line is going to, or each ring, let's put it this way, each ring is called the lamella. Each ring, every single ring. How many rings? I don't know, but it could be different from bone to bone. So we have rings here, one ring, two rings, three rings, four rings, five rings, and these rings are actually formed by matrix. This brown or yellowish area that is composed mostly by deposit of calcium. But here, who are responsible who are making deposit of calcium? These guys who are in these openings. If you see in the previous slide, you see here that these openings are actually called the lacunae. Open eyes, open ears again, lacunae, lacunae, space, lacunae, 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 lacunae. And these lacunae are cavity or little spaces where the osteocytes are going to live. So here inside, who is there? The osteocyte. The osteocyte. Osteocyte. The osteocyte changed name, right? Before they get in surrounded and actually technically trapped without able to go any other place. Before that, the osteocyte was, his name was osteoblast. So the osteoblast was moving, secreting the matrix, and when they get hard and deposit of calcium, they cannot move anymore, creating these spaces called the lacunae. And the osteoblasts who was inside changed name into osteocytes. So osteoblast, very simple, is going to form bone, formation of bone. How? Deposit of calcium in the matrix. Now, the matrix is a substance that the osteoblasts produce when they are crawling, right? Creating the bone. And remember this, it's very fast. These guys are never resting, always they're active. They are changing your bones. The bones are one of the most dynamic structures in your body. They are changing permanently. They are repairing permanently, maintenance permanently. So, and osteocytes is what they are doing, maintenance and repair, repair and maintenance. And we have another one, the osteoclast, that in case that we have low levels of calcium in blood, the osteoclast drill, let's put it this way, some calcium from the bones and take it out into the bloodstream. All right, so I notice here, look at this nice, beautiful picture, very beautiful. Can you see this membrane here coming out from the bone? What is that? That is the periosteum. Periosteum, right? That is the periosteum. All right, so we have the our friend here, the osteocyte. We have here the, you see the difference between this is the spongy, like a sponge, right? Bone that is in the epiphysis called trabecular. Trabecular are like walls, divisions. That's why it's called trabeculae. Spongy or cancellous bone. Okay? So here, our friend here, the osteoblasts, the osteocytes, and these guys representing the osteoclasts. Okay, so another thing we need to remember here, please, is the growth cartilage, where it's located. If you read with a little bit of effort here, use your imagination a little bit, they said epiphyseal plate. So epiphyseal plate, why? Because this plate is located in the epiphysis. And this plate is actually cartilage. This cartilage is called the growth cartilage, epiphyseal plate, or growth plate. So any of these can be used to describe this structure. These mostly are located in the epiphysis of the long bones. Here we have, that is what make you grow, okay? When you grow, this cartilage are going to, when you finish to grow, this plate is going to be closed. It's not going to be present anymore. Okay, so talking about the bones, the bones, what I want you to remember is bone skeleton. We have two main groups of bones, the axial skeleton and the appendicular skeleton. Don't remember 1826, it's just to illustrate, but axial, where is the axial? Axial is what is all the bones are in the center, head and trunk of the body, head and trunk of the body, axial or axial. We have the skull, we have the column, and we have the thorax, and we have the pelvis. That is the axial. The rest is appendicular, okay? So upper and lower extremities. The skull, I want you to remember, the skull is going to be divided in cranial bones and facial bones, skull. So the whole scene is called skull. But the cranium, there is a mistake that everybody seen that, well, somebody, not everybody, seen that cranium is all the skull. Skull and cranium are different definitions. Skull is everything. Skull, everything. Skull is everything. Cranium is only just the posterior portion of the skull. And the anterior portion of the skull is called the facial bones. We have facial bones and we have cranial bones. Cranial bones and facial bones together are going to be called a skull. So please just remember, look at this frontal bone. So do you think the frontal bone is up to here only? No, the frontal bone go even to the top. And here we have the frontal bone, frontal bone, very clear. One posterior, that is the occipital bone, forget about this. Sutures, they just look at the bone. Frontal bone, the occipital bone, frontal bone. We have the parietal lobe. How many parietal lobe we have? Two. One and two. One and two. One and two. And then we have the temporal bones. Temporal bones are going to be all this. This is the temporal bone. So this is part of the temporal bone. They just trying to remark something else. It's not important at this moment. The pterygium is not important. So anyhow, at this moment. So this is the temporal bone. Can you see this is like a red? There is some here red and the other side red. So we have two. One and two temporal bones. One and two parietal bones. One frontal bone only. One occipital bone only. We have the ethmoidal and the sphenoidal bone as part of the cranial bones. Look at this. If we make a mid-sagittal cut of the cranial skull here, we are going to see here's the ethmoidal bone and here's the sphenoidal bone. Do you see? Remember that time I showed you the where is located the pituitary gland. This is like digging in here. So that is part of the sphenoid bone. This is the sphenoid bone. All this is the sphenoid bone. Where is going to be housing the pituitary gland? Okay. Okay. So the mandible. Mandible is part of the facial bone. Maxilla, upper jaw. The lower jaw is the mandible, only one. Maxilla, we have two. Upper jaw, two maxillas, the right and the left. Two zygomatics. Okay? All right. Now here we have a view, we open in transverse view, in transverse cut the cranium. Here we have, and this is the nose, the ear, posterior, this is the occipital bone, this is the frontal bone. So that is this part of the frontal bone, yes. Here we have the sphenoidal bone. Can you see the sphenoidal bone? This is the sphenoids. If you go laterally, when I show you this, this is the sphenoid bone that is part of the cranial bones. Let's make it from here, from above. That is, look like a bird or something. That is the sphenoidal bone. Anteriorly, we have the ethmoidal bone. So, in conclusion, to talk about the cranial bones, we have one frontal, one occipital, two parietals, two temporals, one sphenoidal and one ethmoidal bone. Okay, so what I want to pay attention to in addition is this. What is this? This is an opening. This is an opening where, you remember here we have the cerebellum, we have the cerebrum, we have what? The brain stem. And the brain stem is going to continue with the medulla. The medulla go through the vertebral canal all the way down to the spinal cord, the column. And this is how the spinal cord is coming out from the head, from the cranium, is going to be the foramen magnum. Foramen magnum. So you see, so we need to pay attention to this. Another question, you probably already noticed it. So where is the foramen magnum? Is in the temporal bone? No. It's sphenoidal, ethmoidal, frontal? No. We don't have in the parietal, obviously, right? So this bone, if you see this purple area, this and this and these purple areas are actually the occipital bone. So where is the foramen magnum? Foramen magnum is in the occipital bone. All right, so talking about the ribs, we have true ribs, false ribs, and floating ribs. All the ribs, all 12 ribs, 7, 3, and 2 are 12, all the 12 ribs are being attached posteriorly to the thoracic vertebra. So every single thoracic vertebra has one vertebra, okay? No lumbar, no cervical, only just the thoracic. We have the first 7 is true ribs because anteriorly they attached directly to the sternum. The false ribs, that's number 8, 9, and 10 pair of ribs, is important because you get confused if you don't think about as a pairs. And if I tell you the 8 ribs is still talking about the 8 pair, and the 8 pair is the false rib. Why? Because they are not attached directly to the sternum anteriorly, but through a cartilage. And the floating ribs, as the previous one, they all attach to the posterior to the vertebras, but anteriorly they are not attached to any structure. So that's why these, the 11th and the 12th, are going to be called the floating ribs. Floating ribs. Okay. So here we have the pelvis of the male and the female, right? So there is no structural difference between male and female except for the shape of the pelvis. The rest of the bones are exactly the same. Ribs, femur, ulna, radius, clavicle, etc., all of them. The difference is in the pelvis. Pelvis is more narrow in male, as you see in the picture, and is more wider in female for a delivery, right? All right. So just remember now, the lower extremity, we have a few things we need to remember. The femur, we are not need to remember what is the greater trochanter and the lesser trochanter. The greater trochanter is more lateral, the lesser trochanter is more inner. It's important for some insertions of muscles, but we don't want to memorize that. Just remember the femur. The femur is the largest long bone that we have in the body. We have the patella. Patella is the kneecap, and the patella is to stabilize the motion of the lower extremity, to keep the motion steady, in balance. Tibia, fibula. Tibia is more medial, as we already know. Just to remember, the tibia, more medial, is on the same side of the big toe. The big toe is more medial, right? So the tibia looks like it's more thicker than the fibula. See, you see here, Here we have the tibia and the fibula. Which is more thicker? The tibia, tibia, tibia. And the tibia is in which side? It's in the side of the big toe. Big toe, big bone. Big bone, big toe. And the fibula, fibula is more, if you can see here, fibu lateral. Fibu lateral. Fibu lateral. So fibula is more lateral and tibia is more medial. Tarsal bones is the equivalent of the carpal bones, where is the wrist. Okay, so let's keep going here. I want just to finish this review with a few things here. Number one is the joints, are the joints. We have three group of joints. The synarthrosis, diarthrosis, and amphiarthrosis. Let's start with the most easy to remember is the diarthrosis. So I don't want you to remember fibrous cartilaginous synovial. That is for for a person who is doing going to do a collagenopathy, so whatever, arthritis or something. And rheumatologists, so we don't care about that much. So we just want to know the function of the joints. Synarthrosis, I want you to remember that, amphiarthrosis and diarthrosis. Diarthrosis is upper and lower extremities. Very wide, freely movement of the extremities. We have the opposite. You have full motion in diarthrosis. You don't have any motion in synarthrosis. Synarthrosis is the head sutures, where it's having the contact with the frontal bone and the parietal bone, for example. You are not moving your bones of the head. And in between, so not too much, but not too little, is going to be the amphiarthrosis. That is a slightly movement. So when you bend yourself to pick up a paper from the floor, for example, you bend your spine. So that vertebras are moving. So that is called amphiarthrosis. All right, so here we have, and I want you to pay attention to this, we have different fractures of the bone. So if somebody break your bone, probably one of these are actually the most, what is the most common in adults is actually this impacted fissure mostly. And when you have car accidents, comminuted. This is when you jump from a building, or parachute, I mean. And this is but the most common that I want you to remember is the green stick in children, green stick. So why is called green stick? If you have a stem of a plant that is long and you bend it and put it back suddenly, what happened? That stem is not going to be the same. It's not going to keep the same strength as before. So it's not completely a complete fracture. It's not completely separation of the bone. But if you see the part of that is bended, it's going to get weak. Just remember one thing. You have 24 hours to treat the bone. Why? I told you the bone is very dynamic. If the bone is going to overlap one piece to another piece, in 24 hours you don't do anything, that is going to produce a callus. So it's going to start making a fusion. So your bone is going to stay forever like that. So what we need to do is to produce a therapeutic fracture in purpose in order to reestablish the two ends again. So just remember, very, very, very dynamic organ. All right, so guys, so I think that is about for today. What time is it? All right, so actually it was almost 1 hour review. I'm going to open microphones. Now, first of all, I'm going to just, I need to just stop.